Now we're starting our stakeholder plenary session of this morning. The modalities for the stakeholder session are the same as on the very first day. We will have a series of discussions that we identified in advance, and we will alternate again between the entire stakeholder plenary and those discussions, and really try to see a discussion among all stakeholders here in the room. So the title of the session is Taking Stock and the Way Forward. And before I go into the details, I just want to second what Bertrand already said. Thank you for all the hard work yesterday. Internet and jurisdictions' main mission is to enable multi-stakeholder cooperation, and here at this first global internet and jurisdiction conference, we saw yesterday 200 participants from all stakeholder groups, from all continents, and from all the different policy silos working together in the three work streams in order to find ways to address those challenges and come up with solutions. So thank you for all the hard work. And I think what has become clear in the discussions yesterday is that we need more dialogue and we need more cooperation to preserve the cross-border nature of the internet for the future of the global digital economy, for the future of human rights online, and for the future of cybersecurity. So this stakeholder plenary is intended to hear your feedback here in the room about the reporting you have just heard, and especially about joint policy priorities and areas for coordination and cooperation. Where did we achieve progress? What has become clearer? And what should be our collective next steps? And before we do this, I think it is very useful to remember that for policy discussions to be successful, they need to be firmly grounded in evidence. This is important to make informed policy decisions and also be aware of unintended consequences of such decisions. And I just want to take 1 second to highlight that the Internet and Jurisdiction Policy Network is supported by the INJ Observatory. And the INJ Observatory is composed of 31 leading experts from 27 universities in 17 countries around the world. And Internet and Jurisdiction is committed to enhance this research output to support policy innovation. One resource that is already available since 2012 for all stakeholders is the INJ Retrospect Database. And our next INJ Observatory meeting will take place at Oxford University, and the Internet and Jurisdiction Observatory is also currently finalizing its first knowledge partnership with CG, a leading think tank in Canada. But coming back to addressing the challenges of maintaining the cross-border internet while respecting the rule of law, or rather the rule of laws online, we would now like to ask you, the stakeholders in the room, how did the areas of cooperation and policy priorities that you discussed yesterday, that you just heard being highlighted again this morning, resonate with you? What should be our modalities for joint action? How can we ensure policy coherence? And how can we collectively reach the tipping point from constructive dialogue to collaborative action to address those jurisdiction challenges on the internet? So with that, I would like to open the session. Our first discussant of this plenary is Erin Dorgan. She's the Director of International Telecommunications Policy and Coordination in the Department of Innovation, Science and Economic Development of Canada. You have the floor.
Good morning, bonjour. C'est un grand plaisir d'être ici aujourd'hui. Et j'aimerais premièrement remercier les organisateurs. Thank you, Bertrand and Paul, for organizing, I think, what's been a series of really timely and relevant discussions over the past 2 days. Fundamentally, I think these are really challenging issues. We're trying to find practical solutions to really big challenges dealing with territoriality and transnational cooperation. I think, Bertrand, you mentioned, you made the observation on the first day that these are issues where people have a tendency to try to solve them based on sort of where they're seated. And you know, therein lies, I think, one of the challenges. And I think one of our challenges is that efforts really need to move beyond any one particular interest, any one particular perspective, any one particular institution, and really recognize the collective opportunity here. And recognizing that, I think, to start to to find ways to address these challenges of territoriality on the global internet, it's really going to require multi-stakeholder innovation. So I think when we look at discussions to advance thinking about procedural approaches in the areas of data and content and domains, it's really important to include a broad range of actors from the private sector and academics, technical community and civil society. As for us governments, I think we need to remain flexible, we need to be creative, we need to be imaginative in our approaches, and really develop effective public policy and legal frameworks that reinforce the internet's global reach. I think governments need to take into account the operational realities of those handling transactions, dealing with data, content, and domains. And I think governments also need to be open to the possibility of progress being made from the bottom up. The internet has obviously evolved into a powerful enabler for users, and it's incumbent on us to ensure that any proposed measures will adequately reflect the needs and expectations of internet users both now and in the future. So before concluding, I'll just share some initial thoughts on some of the suggested areas for possible ways forward. I think the points that we just heard outlined will help to bring focus to some of these operational challenges, and I'm pleased to note that they include areas for cooperation, such as working toward a shared vernacular or language to facilitate interoperability, or also increasing transparency about how requests are made and handled. I think these are areas where progress is probably quite achievable. And lastly, I think it's worth restating that I think attentiveness as to how we approach these challenges and opportunities will be at least as important as any result. And today's policy decisions and actions are influencing the future of the global internet. I think bottom-up efforts will be important to furthering this important conversation, and I think thanks to the efforts of projects such as these, I think we're gaining further insights and seeing where opportunities exist. And I think there's also room for these exchanges to inform and enrich efforts taking place on other tracks. So I see I've gone over, so I'll stop there. Merci.
Thank you. Thank you. Thank you very much. Our next discussant is Elfa Gylfadottir. She's the director of the Media Commission of Iceland, and she's here, above all, as the chair of the Steering Committee on Media and Information Society of the Council of Europe. You have the floor, please.
Thank you very much. Yes, you're right. As the chair of the Steering Committee, I'm representing both very big countries in Europe and also the very small countries in Europe. And I just want to reflect on a couple of issues. I was taking part in this content workflow yesterday, and I think that we came to a common conclusion that we will never have the same values, and we will never come to a conclusion in that regard. But to have this discussion and maybe to work on processes, due processes, I think that is extremely important. I have been engaged with this work for 10 years, met many of you in these circumstances. And what I find, which is the added value of what we are doing here, is that we are focusing on different issues that that we could actually find some some answers to. And just putting people in the room, having a multi-stakeholder dialogue in this way, and try to pinpoint where can we actually agree on things, I think that is extremely valuable. From a government perspective, talking from Iceland, for example, it is extremely frustrating not to live in and be from a jurisdiction where intermediaries don't really recognize you because you're too small. But I'm also following what is happening in larger jurisdictions. I'm actually have the privilege of living now in the city of Münster, where the peace process was taking place in Westphalia. So I'm also looking at what is the situation in Germany. And there you can also see that it's extremely important, you know, to have these dialogue, and the process is not very encouraging, I have to say. So both from a coming from a standpoint of a large country or a small country, I mean, this dialogue needs to take place, and all the stakeholders must be in the room and find a solution. And we have to have a process which is inclusive for all stakeholders and for both big and small governments. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you very much. And I would now like to give the floor to Gianfranco Incarnato. Gianfranco Incarnato is the Deputy Director General for Political Affairs and Security at the Italian Ministry of Foreign Affairs and International Cooperation, and he is, among others, also in charge of the organization of the EG7 next year. You have the floor.
Thank you. Thank you very much. I must admit, following your activities, your work, I was obliged to change my points, not indulging too much on the G7 programs, but to stress, to raise some concerns that could also be disappointing, but nevertheless, I would list with you some headlines, at least the headlines we have on the table, urging consideration from our side. Just a few days ago, Mr. Hammond declared that the UK was developing offensive cyber capabilities. This was only one part of a speech launching a £2 billion investment in a new cyber security strategy. Needless to remind you, last month, US and Russia declarations, and Russia saying, "Ah, now you say so because you were and you are prepared for those actions." But we will come soon to some new terms. But Russia, since Russia's war on Georgia, offensive cyber capabilities is as much part. It's clear that offensive cyber capabilities are part of fighting a modern war, as planes or missiles. Not anyone was therefore surprised to learn that UK and the US have been using cyber offensive capabilities to cut Islamic State off from the internet. But again, rules of this kind of game have yet to be written. To stress again that most leaders want the cornerstone of their government to be security. Cybersecurity is no exception. I will remind another headline. In August, the French and German ministers of interior urged the EU institutions to propose new rules that would compel operators of internet messaging services to help authorities decrypt private communication as part of terror investigations. We are also trying to cope with the dark web, because we were discussing about many important things, but it's odd to remind us that the dark web is by way far larger than the open discussions we can have on the internet. But finally, in July, let me remember, NATO summit in Warsaw declared cyberspace as the fifth domain. Well, the key question today is in our agenda, what actually constitutes an act of cyber warfare? An intrusion? Stuxnet? Many are thinking about the threshold when an attack is catastrophic enough or destructive enough that war we define it as we define it as an act of war. Let me remind you that 2 years ago, many countries were motivated by the shared goal of preventing conflict between states in cyberspace, thus affirming the applicability of the rights to self-defense, as recognized in Article 51 of the UN Charter. Applicability of the law of armed conflicts, but how to define its fundamental principles: humanity, necessity, proportionality, distinction. Well, we in Italy, we do think that cyber arms control and arms limitation agreements are necessary. We should limit state-developed offensive cyber capabilities. We should create specialized communication systems among cyber commands. As you probably know, US and China have engaged in talks about a cyber arms control code of conduct. But we do not know if it includes pledges of no first use. Let me conclude by saying, on a personal note, that if key cyber powers are unwilling to participate, others could start building a foundation for a cyber arms control regime. Final note, let me commend your work. Keep going, because if we have to now derail our priorities somewhere else, we definitely know you to be active, to continue working hard, because at some point we will probably join you again. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much, and I think those comments highlighted that the discussions we're having here don't happen in a vacuum, and that it's important to keep all the different dimensions and the entire ecosystem in mind when we discuss this. And I think this stresses why cooperation is so important. I would now like to take four discussions from the entire stakeholder plenary. The rules are the same as yesterday. Please raise your hand. The microphone will come to your place. Stand up. Tell us who you are and what organization you're representing here today. Who would like to go first?
And Paula, if I may add one thing, just like we said earlier, a customary question that we ask is, why are you here? The customary question at the end is, if you were to take one thing, one takeaway, one thing that struck you, one thing that surprised you, that you understood better, that you want to share, or that you find is showing the way forward, what would it be? So if you have one thing that you would like to pick, don't hesitate to mention it in your comments.
The first finger there.
Hello, I guess you asked us to stand up. I'm Peter Swire, I was the moderator for track one. I wanted to point out the trajectory of change on the data track over the last few years. So MLATs, mutual legal assistance, was not a major policy issue 3 or 4 years ago for most people. The United States had a review group on NSA that listed it as an important issue for the internet at the end of 2013. In 2015, some academics and some stakeholder groups started to happen, especially in the United States, but also with Europe. But in 2016, we have an important agreement proposed between the US and UK. In 2016, the EU Commission has an action plan for deliverables by next year. The Council of Europe is doing work now on an official track. And so the level of sort of institutionalization of this issue is clearly becoming much greater. Also in India and Brazil and other countries outside of the US and Europe, there's been important developments in the last year. So I have two things that I'd like to emphasize in closing. One is that because this issue is happening much more, it seems like thickening the network of connections, having more people in more directions speaking to each other, is important so that the Commission and India and the United States and the police and the ministers and civil society and academics, these different sorts of players get to understand better the perspectives, because you need technology and law and economics to work to make this work. And the second thing is, I leave for Charles de Gaulle at 11:30, and if anybody wants to ride together, please let me know.
Thank you very much. Yes, can we have a microphone over there, please?
Hi, I'm Daphne Keller. Can you hear me? I'm the Director for Intermediary Liability at the Center for Internet and Society at Stanford. I've been working on cross-border notice and takedown issues in some capacity for 13 years, 14, too long. And what's really striking to me about the conversation here is the difference between the three tracks. It seems to me that the track that's talking about law enforcement access to data is very far along in the conversation. You have concrete proposals. It's clear what the questions are to pull out. And part of the reason for that, I think, is because there are strong government interests in arriving at an answer. There's a lot of pressure on that one. It's striking to me also hearing the report from the people in the DNS conversation, what a great sense of urgency there is there. Clearly, there is a big change going on and a need for that conversation to just move faster. And then as to the cross-border notice and takedown content issues that I work on, I feel like we're a little bit more static. You know, we haven't changed what we're saying that much in the past year, and we're all sort of in a state of suspension waiting to see what happens with the Equistec case or the Kamel case. And so my takeaway from that observation, which is really a request to Paul and Bertrand to do more work for us all, is for those who do have insight into all three of those tracks at once, what can we learn from one to inform the others? Because in many cases, the legal questions really are different. You know, the legal questions about even what you can do as a technical response to a data request, which is either provide the data or don't, versus what you can do as a technical response to a removal request, which includes geographically specific actions. There are such differences that we can't kind of have a grand overarching theory of legal jurisdiction, but I think there are a lot of smaller connection points where we could be helping each other out, and Bertrand and Paul, we're counting on you guys to provide those connections. Thank you.
Thank you. Yes, over there.
Thank you, Alex McGillivray, AMAC, here in my personal capacity. I wanted to make three very quick points. First, on behalf of all the native English speakers here, I just wanted to thank you all for doing this conference in English. It makes it so much easier for us, and I know it makes everybody else tired, so please thank you. Number two, I wanted to make one more plug for a simple phone book or contact list as something that could come out of the conference and be very helpful on at least the first two tracks. And then number three, I wanted to point out, maybe in opposition to Daphne's point, that the thing that sort of tied a bunch of these tracks together, I think that is that we have come into, maybe it's the institutionalization or the default, being that a bunch of stuff that we could get either from the user or in conversation with the user, so the user's information, the takedown of content, the user's domain name, not asking the user for that, but assuming that we can ask a third party for that. And now we're talking about which governments get to be in that group, and how, what might the limits on that be, but basically we've assumed that we can take the user out of the equation. And I wanted to point out, this is, I don't think, a near-term thing, but that over the long term, that may not be sustainable. And particularly as we abuse that power to go around the user, that we might have a problem with that.
Thank you very much. I take one more intervention before we go back to the discussants. Yes, can we have a microphone here, please?
Thanks very much. Appreciate it. My name is Rebecca McKinnon. I direct the Ranking Digital Rights Project out of the New America Foundation. I'm scheduled to speak in the final session, but I wanted to jump in here because I want to insert something in a little earlier so that there's time to talk about it before everybody runs the Charles de Gaulle. Just related to overarching, cross-cutting things, the transparency issue is clearly one thing where I would really like to see a cross-cutting effort that's not siloed by, you know, data / privacy, content / expression and domains. I'd like to see the transparency cross-cutting effort really to involve people from all of the tracks. And just to emphasize what came out of the content slash expression group. I prefer to call it expression. content's like what you put in a bucket. Is the importance of getting governments to start acting and to start seeing some pilot efforts that help to inform best practice and can begin to serve as models, both in relation to requests to either block or remove or restrict content, but also in terms of data-related requests, that we need to start to see government transparency reporting and a model emerging for that, and that is urgent, that we begin to see that for all the reasons that have already been articulated that I won't repeat, other than to just put a big plus one on it. The second thing, there were two other things that came up in the content slash expression track that weren't mentioned in the summary, but I want to bring up because I also think they're cross-cutting. One has to do with remedy. I think we need to see some cross-cutting efforts dealing with that, because that's where you really can get to accountability issues that are hard to get to in other ways, and remedy is really not being dealt with in an adequate manner. Third, relates to human rights impact assessments, which is another cross-cutting issue that deals both with privacy and expression, that I really feel that we need to start seeing. We need to try to work with some governments on some pilot efforts around whether it be the drafting of legislation or the implementation of regulation and legislation or the enforcement thereof at the different stages, a model for doing impact assessment, not only for people within the jurisdiction where this law or regulation is being implemented, but more broadly on human rights across the internet, privacy and expression, and how it's affecting users elsewhere across jurisdictions. And so therefore, I think it's very much in scope for an internet and jurisdiction project to help governments think through and have a conversation with stakeholders about the cross-jurisdictional impacts of implementation and enforcement coming out of one jurisdiction. I think this particular group is uniquely situated to do some work on that and to identify one or two governments that would be willing to really take the lead on this. And this was something that over a week ago I was preparing to write things calling for the U.S. to exercise leadership in this area. Now I call on other governments, please, please exercise leadership in this area while there's still a possibility of doing so. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you very much. Our next discussant is Carlos Afonso Souza. He's the director of the Institute for Technology and Society in Rio, which is also the current chair of the Network of Centers, and he is a member of the INJ Observatory and also of the advisory group of this conference. You have the floor.
So, thanks, Paul. Thanks, Bertrand, and to the whole Internet Jurisdiction Secretariat and staff for putting up this great meeting. I would like to quickly come back to one thing that Paul mentioned right in the beginning of this session, which is how do we improve better inform policy making in the area? And for that regard, the IEJ Observatory might be something for us to take a look on, especially because the website has just been relaunched. And I'm not sure if all of you have been through the website and took a look on the Internet and Jurisdiction Retrospect database, but this is a very important feature for the issue of having more informed policymaking in different jurisdictions, because you can track trends and see
what are the topics that different states have been tackling through since 2012 up to now. It's a searchable database, so you can look for one specific issue or one specific tool or one specific topic that has been discussed. So this is a powerful tool for us to take a look on what's happened outside of our jurisdictions and to have lessons learned from previous experiences. And to talk about the issue of previous experiences and just to take a look on how that might be some like chain gang effect from what happens in one jurisdiction to the other, we have been discussing a lot the issue of the right to be forgotten, and it's only natural that that happened. It ended up appearing, of course, in the content work stream as well. And yesterday, we heard the representative of KNIL mentioning something that it was quite interesting, especially coming from a Brazilian, in which he said like the right to be delisted is a right for Europeans in Europe, not for Brazilians in Brazil and Chinese in China. And it's really striking because, of course, that is pretty much true. But at the same time, once the European Court of Justice take a decision on the so-called right to be forgotten in 13th of May of 2014, and I remember the date because that's my birthday. And as soon as you get the decision like that, it's interesting to see how that might react and impact different jurisdictions. And I would like just to pinpoint the situation of Brazil. Because if you look on the decisions that have been made in the Court of Appeals of the state of São Paulo, until May 2014, we had only four cases that have dealt with the two keywords, which will be right to be forgotten and the internet. Right after May 2014, we have 42 cases deciding on 42 decisions on right to be forgotten and the internet. So I believe this is just a small example on how decisions that are taking outside of one country might impact, not because of a transnational need of cooperation, but simply because some other country might feel inspired and want to tackle on this decision or in this policy decision that had been made by a government or by a court of justice. And that's something for us to take a look on. So thanks for that.
Thank you very much. Our next discussant is Tarek Kamel. Tarek Kamel is the senior advisor to the president of ICANN for government engagement, and ICANN is also one of the institutional supporters of the Global Internet and Jurisdiction Conference. You have the floor.
Thank you, Paul, and I will start by tackling a cross-cutting issue across the three work streams that I have been observing within the last 2 days. First of all, this policy network seemed to be having an excellent start in its first conference, where we thank Bertrand and Paul and the team. We have just the right number of people, of participants for the first time, not too many and not too few, and was the right level. But looking forward, in order to gain and keep global momentum, we need to be more inclusive and we need to open up. And we need, in order really to gain also recognition and legitimacy. This topic is a sensitive topic. It is not like ICANN's topic, for example, 10, 15 years ago when it comes about business or technical resources, so it can come with time. No, sovereignty is for each country of importance and equal importance and is sensitive. And if it happens that we will go through another divide, north-south divide, or we are too much US-centric or European-centric, we'll leave a bunch of many regions around the world, in Asia and in Africa, behind. And then we have again what we see in multilateral fora concerning divides and concerning different policies. So we urge you really and tell us how to help you in order to open up and in order to be more inclusive and to keep and gain the momentum really, because we have the right model of a multi-stakeholder model to move forward in this important issue. If it needs capacity building, then we we should work together as a global community on capacity building, especially that we are not talking here to the obvious organizations of operators, but we are talking to different new players from the judiciary system and from different ministries as such that need to be included in the system, whether from the private sector or from the different ministries. And my last message is the last track of the domain names. The discussions were very interesting. It's not easy, but it might be a little bit easier than others to look into it, as it has a community that is already well structured via the ICANN community and can take it forward. So maybe we can look at that. But again, the message: please be inclusive. Keep on the momentum in order really to have recognition further on and legitimacy while we move forward. Thank you very much.
Thank you. Thank you for stressing this very important point. Our next speaker is Dunja Mijatovic. She's the representative on freedom of the media of the OSCE. Dunja, you have the floor.
Thank you, Paul. It's wonderful to be back to and to attend the event that was organized by Bertrand and Paul. My office is part of these discussions since the very beginning of the project, focusing on the issues that are very much related to the work we are doing, and that's really human rights and freedom of expression. So my intervention is going to be a bit different, and I will also not try to repeat what is already said. What we are hearing here and what is extremely important to recognize is that this is a group more or less of like-minded people. We have very similar views on what needs to be done, and particularly on what shouldn't be done in order to keep the internet safe and free and open for all. The reality outside this room is quite different, and I'm talking based on the facts and based on the work I'm doing with my team. I'm focusing here on the moves by the governments. Carl Bildt, on the first day of the opening, said it's very important that we take approach step by step, slowly discussing issues, and I think it's extremely important. But while we are having this step by step approach, what is happening in the real world is quite dangerous. The moves by the governments, restrictions, blocking, and filtering is happening as we speak. The year 2016 has been an unprecedented surge on government surveillance, restrictions, blockages, and filtering of the internet. What is also something that I think it's important to take away from here is how is this affecting individuals. And I will not focus on the journalists, which is obviously my job, but I think it's important to talk about netizens and what is happening to the real people and how they are affected with these moves by many governments. Sometimes discussions, and I'm not focusing on this discussion here, but on many discussions my office is taking part at the UN, European Commission, Council of Europe, my own organization, OSCE, we have a bit of discussion in a bubble because we do not talk about the realities. We do not talk about people that are directly affected by these restrictions and how we can find a way to engage with governments that are not willing to listen to this forum or any other forum and are just continuing to use the powers they have in order to restrict free speech and to affect people by surveillance, by imprisoning them, intimidating them, harassing them by using the tools that are available to them. So how to reach out and how to do this, what Rebecca McKinnon was just proposing, in order to find governments that are willing to work, in order to try to learn on mistakes. We also have to be realistic that 50% of population worldwide is offline still. how to work on access and how to make sure that access to these people that are offline is done in a bit different way than what we are experiencing now, all of us that are online. At least we are trying, but not at this conference, and I think there is a conspiracy behind this. This is not the first time this is happening, and I think, you know, this is a, some kind of agreement between internet jurisdiction, dear colleagues, in order to make us do more work. So I will end this because I think many things were said already, but I do not think we should push away this human dimension away from this discussion. And I know it's important to have you know, cross-cutting issues on data, on transparency, on openness. It's crucial. And we are not lacking experts. This is a group of people that are worldwide experts on so many issues. And I think the result at the end has to be a good result. But please, you know, do not push away this part of a discussion too far away. And I know it's the most sensitive one and the most delicate one, but still crucially important.
I want to echo what you just said, that actually connects with what Nenna was saying also yesterday or the day before yesterday regarding how to engage and take at least the perspective of the users. It was mentioned already by Alexander as well. This is one of the big challenges, is how to make sure that it is, to take Tarek's world, inclusive, not only towards other regions, which is one of the things that we really plan to do next year, but also to this category of actors, and making sure that the perspective of the user is not only taken into account in the discussions, but also in the regimes that are being put in place. And this is why notification, for instance, was such an important element to see emerge. I know that Elfa wanted to make one comment on something that was mentioned before.
Thank you very much. Yes, I just wanted to take the floor because Rebecca was saying that the governments needs to come to the table and take responsibility. And I'm not really sure if everybody in this room knows that the 47 member states of the Council of Europe actually decided upon an internet freedom recommendation. So for those who don't know that, if you are stakeholders from academia, from civil society, from the companies and so forth, the member states have actually agreed on certain elements, like, for example, to periodically evaluate the level of respect for implementation of human rights, that there is a multi-stakeholder process that needs to be taken into account when policy is being made, law is being processed, and so forth. So I just wanted to mention this. So this is already in place in this and is an initiative of these 47 member states in the Council of Europe. Thank you.
Thank you. I give a mic again to Dunja. Where's Mark? So I had something.
Short remark on this, what I was saying. It is marvelous what the Council of Europe did and many other international organizations. And if we just focus on the internet freedom, we can just also look at the UN Human Rights Council, a landmark resolution on internet freedom, which recognized for the first time that our human rights are the same offline and online. UN, many other forums and many international organizations coming together, states coming together and accepting very strong words and resolutions, and I would say, you know, something that should be welcomed. But then again, in reality, they do not value and honor those words on paper. And those words on paper are, you know, tremendous. They are great. But then you look at, I will not mention countries here, Council of Europe countries, OSCE participating states, UN member states, and they say we all respect, etc. But then you go and you discuss issues with the governments of you know, people being detained or harassed because of, you know, Facebook posts or social media posts, not to go further in this discussion. The question is, what do we do with those states? How do we engage with them? How we make them implement what they voluntarily agreed upon? Nobody forced them. The reality nowadays is not just on internet freedom. Everything that is related to human rights is under question mark, because we have great resolutions, great recommendations, guidelines, but that's it. And of course, I'm not talking about each and every state. There are states that are really serious when they say so, but majority, I would say, is not something that is helpful for all advocates and all people engaging in these discussions.
In this regard, I think there has been indeed, like Peter was saying, regarding the evolution of the topic in the last few years, on the specific issue. In general, there has been a serious move on the adoption of lots of principles, and that's a very good thing. And I know that the UN has also adopted things on privacy, and I know that Germany and Brazil have been proactive in pushing this. It's the basis on which it is now possible to discuss further the implementation, and this is where, of course, the devil being in the details, as we all know, the whole debate between should we try to harmonize the values or the criteria, or should we get onto the procedural guarantees, and the reason why due process is emerging as one of this anchor is that it's a way to have here a vernacular that should be acceptable to describe how to embed those human rights and those principles into actual practice. That's probably one of the ways to go forward. There's another comment, please, and then we'll break for... It will come, don't worry.
Hi. Can everybody hear me?
No, but it will come. Yes.
Okay, good.
Yes, slow, but...
Reintroduce myself, Chuck Tobin from Holland & Knight, law firm in Washington, D.C. First of all, thank you to INJ and Bertrand and my friend Liz Finberg from Public Interest Registry for getting me involved, inviting me to join. Very eye-opening experience, really delightful to get to meet and network with a number of good folks, and I know I'm personally going to continue the dialogue with a number of you. I participated in the content and jurisdiction work stream, the expression work stream, if you will, and I had a couple of takeaways and thoughts. One is that I have been trying to inject in a number of different forums here the notion of the cross-cultural differences and the difficulty that that is going to continue to pose for cross-border enforcement if we don't recognize certain cultural values, right to be forgotten, and things that are an integral part of your laws. They're going to be difficult for United States actors to accept orders from foreign courts, and our encouragement that you avail yourself of the domestic courts of the United States. That's a takeaway and a problem that I don't think that we're all ready to confront and solve, and that we've frankly marginalized and pushed to the side as an insoluble issue at the moment. I look forward to further conferences where we can try and confront those issues head on. On a more encouraging note, I learned a heck of a lot from this room and from these folks here about the other issues of transparency, data management, ideas and strategies of working with your governments and where to confront your governments and engage in dialogues with your governments. And as a representative of the American news media interest, I'm going to take those messages back to the rooms of people like this one, where we all sit around and we talk about the evolving internet norms and practices as it affects the American news media. I'm encouraged that Bertrand is going to participate in one of those discussions when we hold a conference in New Orleans, happens to be a French-speaking town, so it'll be culturally comfortable as well for Bertrand. But I would encourage the rest of you and the folks in this room and this organization to incorporate some of the content providers, the American news media, the Le Monde, the Guardian, Der Spiegel, some of the people who are the biggest propagators of the information that are the subjects of takedown demands, court orders, requests, and that are very frightened by the whole Google Spain and right to be forgotten discussion. I think if we're ever going to get to the issue of cross-cultural differences on content and how that informs the goals and missions of this organization, you're going to need those folks in the room, and you'll find them very willing and cooperative participants in these kinds of open dialogues. So thank you again for inviting me to participate.
Thank you. Philip, go ahead. Microphone. And same rule as usual, 3 minutes, and so on.
I'll be very short. Well, thank you, first of all, for inviting us. My name is Philip Aman. I'm heading the strategy section of the European Cybercrime Center. So we're the guys who have the boots on the ground. We're directly affected by some of the challenges that we've identified, we all have identified in the area of legislation. So I have 4 points. So one is, to thank you to have us, also participate in this event and to apologize that we couldn't make it for the full event, but it's important, so important for us that, I came in this morning just to show our support as well. The second point is just to quickly tell you who we are. So we are the EU Center to Combat Cybercrime. We are a very special organization in the sense we're part of Europol, in the sense that our director would refer to us as the the Uber or Airbnb of law enforcement, because we don't have policing powers, but we are very successful in applying the multi-stakeholder model to law enforcement. So we are very effective in getting all the stakeholders together to combat serious and organized crime on the internet. And that's really what we do. So operationally, we are usually involved in large-scale, multinational, international operations, combating cybercrime in three areas: pure cybercrime, payment fraud, and combating child sexual abuse online. The third point is then, what is it that we see? So that's part of my job. We do a lot of forward-looking assessments. We look at the facts and the figures. And what we see is quite worrying, to be honest with you. We see a mature underground industry fueling cybercrime, providing services and tools for people to commit cybercrime. We see a lot of non-traditional crime moving into the cyberspace, fraud and extortion and things like that. And also, of course, those tools and services are available to everyone, not just cyber criminals. And that also means, because it's international and borderless, all the cases we're involved in involve two or more jurisdictions. So effective cross-border cooperation, effective exchange of evidence is absolutely essential to our investigations. We couldn't do without that. Second, effective public-private partnerships, working with the private industry, also an extremely crucial element of our work, because they usually hold the evidence, they control the infrastructure. And then in a third area, because we deal with child sexual abuse online, but we also have a center now, as of this year, dealing with combating terrorism. Notice and takedown is another area that is really important for us. So just to sum up, we're really supportive of the work of this of this policy network. It's really important to us. We also are here to support you. So if you ever wanted to have the facts and figures, because that's our approach, we try to take the emotions out of the discussion, but we're happy also to provide the trends and the figures to support your discussion. Thank you.
Thank you very much for having joined, even at this late stage. So the rest of the interventions are more about how to take out of the discussion, but I'm very glad that you were able to join us right now. Thomas Schneider, over there, behind you.
Thank you, my name is Thomas Schneider, I work for the Swiss government, and I first want to thank Paul and Bertrand for this great initiative and this great meeting. And I had a problem that I actually would have wanted to be in all three work streams, in particular in the content one, as I have been working with Elva and a number of other friends on all of these nice papers that she has tried to refer to about human rights in the digital world. But given my current role as chairman of ICANN's Governmental Advisory Committee, of course, I had to go to the domain part, which is also very challenging. And I think what is important is that people use this network as a tool to try to solve their issues or find their way through the institutions in a better way. Because ICANN is suffering to some extent under the fact that people have an issue with intellectual property rights, with protection of geographic names, with a number of issues that basically ICANN has no mandate to solve, but they come there because they try to solve their problems via some kind of control or impact over domain names, where actually they are targeting the content that may be on these domain names. And this is not a very efficient way of doing it, because most of these, or many of these works, are dead ends. And if something gets done, normally it has externalities in terms of extraterritorial effects, because ICANN is is of course based in one particular jurisdiction, and the contracts are probably hooked up to one particular jurisdiction that may actually vary. So contracts can be made or based on different jurisdictions also in ICANN. But it is something that I think we realize that all stakeholders are doing an enormous amount of work trying to take care of all these issues, but it's not coordinated, and we run into a lot of dead ends and with waste of energy. And what I would expect, and this is a comment with regard to a way forward, in particular on that work stream, is that if this network can help create something like an orientation tree for people that have issues that they hope to solve via domain names, that they find out what other better alternatives would be, where to go and address these issues instead of trying to go to ICANN and burden this mainly technical system with issues that shouldn't be dealt with in ICANN. But also at the same time, ICANN needs to have the courage to say no, and maybe not delegating a domain name if that domain name would change a balance that it should be discussed, or a balance that should be struck elsewhere. So it's actually a mutual benefit if this network would be used by ICANN and by the people that come to ICANN to actually try and solve problems elsewhere and not necessarily in the ICANN structure. So this is one of my takeaways, and I hope you can operationalize the different work streams on different levels. Normally it's three work streams with three levels when Bertrand is involved, of course. There are always three layers, those who know that. And I want to end just with one thing that I think is important, and to me that has been like the fundraiser for many processes that I'm part of, like Eurodic, like the Swiss IGF. Now I'm trying to raise funds for the GAC Secretariat, because that's paid on a voluntary basis by governments. So governments who are here who have not yet committed to giving some money to the independent part of the GAC Secretariat, I will go after you. And I just want to add in this regard here, and actually compete my own fundraising, that I think we all like and support this process. But as you know, there's only limited free lunches, because normally somebody else is paying for it. So if you want this network to play the role that I think it could play and it should play, so you would need to join or think joining those like my government office who is not just giving money to Eurodig and to the GAC Secretariat and to blah, 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 but we are also supporting this project financially. And I just invite you all to think about supporting this network too. Thank you very much.
I certainly wouldn't object. Thank you so much, Thomas. Eileen?
Hi, Eileen Donahoe. I've been playing a variety of roles in this space. I was...
if you can stand up maybe so that the camera catch you.
So I was at the UN Human Rights Council when that first foundational resolution was passed on online as offline protection of human rights. I was then at... Human Rights Watch as Director of Global Affairs, and now I'm a distinguished fellow at CG, which is now collaborating with Bertrand's group. I just wanted to make a pitch for something that the Internet and Jurisdiction Project could make as a primary project, which is more in the advocacy vein. We've all talked about a sense of urgency inside this room about the various conflicts that we see and the risks we see. I don't think there is adequate sense of urgency outside this room. And in particular, I think we need to convey and have a shared narrative about really what's at stake in the world, in the larger world. Two big dimensions there from my point of view. One is that if all of the countries that claim to be champions of human rights do not think seriously about the extraterritorial effects of their assertions of jurisdiction, we will, in our own, if you combine our collective actions, be undermining the internet as a global platform for the free flow of information, free flow of goods, and the exercise of human rights. And similarly, when we talk about the diversity of our perspectives about how to implement human rights, which certainly was a dominant strand in the content stream, I agree that there is room for cultural diversity in implementation. But we all need to remember that we must be advocates for the universal application of human rights and the universality of human rights inhering in the human person. And if we fail to do that because we're so busy imposing or exercising our domestic jurisdiction in our own ways, we will lose both the universal human rights framework and the global interoperable internet. And I really think we all have to be careful about that. So in our group, we talked about the concept of at least do no harm to those two big things that we all care about and share a sense of urgency about protecting them as we all seek to figure out a way to exercise jurisdiction.
Thank you very much, Aileen, and I would say that one of the major outcomes for us in this event is to have a strong shared message by the participants, not only something that we would be promoting, which we have in the paper that we produced for the Global Commission on Internet Governance, this is a legal arms race to transnational cooperation, but now we have the capacity when we will be outreaching next year to say, actually those 200 people were sending a very strong message about the dangers of inaction and so on. So thank you, that is empowering us to be more on an advocacy basis in that regard, not on the solution, but on the problem. I think gentleman over there, and then I think.
Hello, my name is Braxton Perkins. I'm with NBC Universal. Happy to be here. Thanks to Bertrand and Paul for hosting this forum. I really came here to do a lot of listening in work stream two with intellectual property issues, really sort of not fully in scope. Happy to listen and to the work stream and hear the reports out on the others, but with a lot of background in handling copyright concerns for creators who are passionate about human rights or passionate about connecting with users on the internet, really two things that I heard that I wanted to comment on. One is cost and resources. I think in both work stream three and in two, there is the issue that the increase in requests creates cost burdens. And I think that's true both for people making requests and for the requestees. And it leads to the second point, which is when you have cost, one of the ways you look to create efficiencies to decrease that cost is technology. And I think in the other plenaries, we talked about, you know, what's the engineering perspective? What are some of the technical tools that are going to become available to users? I think that's an area that probably more discussion is needed, not just for users, but also for people making requests, as well as for the requestees. How do we have technology that can help with process, due process, as well as identifying the scale of requests that may be required? Thanks.
Thank you very much. Greg?
Hi, I'm working now. I'm Greg Nogein from the Center for Democracy and Technology, and I just want to build on Eileen's comments. I was in Workstream 1, the data workstream, and one thing that surprised me in the workstream was how much time we were devoting to the notice issue. And one representative of one country got up and said, we never give notice. We don't give notice because we think that keeping the investigation confidential protects both the subject of the investigation and other people who might be wrapped up in it. So we never give notice. We think it's a civil liberties protection. I think that was a minority view in the room. But as we move toward trying to reach common standards about when a cross-border demand should be honored, I think we have to start talking about not minimum standards, which was often said during the discussion, but strong human rights standards. And we have to be prepared to give a little bit in order to get a lot and preserve these human rights principles that I think virtually every member state in this group has already agreed to. And I'm very worried about, in the effort to reach commonality, that we're going to reach the lowest common denominator. And I'm very interested in mechanisms to make sure that the effort to move toward commonality doesn't result in a move toward the lowest common denominator in terms of rights protected. Thank you.
After I make this comment, I have to run to another conference in London that's coincidentally titled, Do We Still Have a Single Internet? So,
In 2025.
Excuse me?
That's the title. In 2025.
Oh, in 2025. That's right. He is participating as well. Anyway, so excuse me if I don't remain to receive feedback to my comments. I think that we have to make distinction between making the internet global and making data access and takedown global, because those are two different things. The internet is already global. I mean, what fragments the internet is censorship and surveillance done by the legal regimes that are imposed, superimposed upon the internet. And this is what, I mean, being in Europe, I'll just make some references. That's what Jürgen Habermas will call something like colonization of the life world with the system. And this is what Jacques Lacan will call, you know, the symbolic world trying to suffocate the real, that's trying to, you know, break out of the symbolic system. So the way to keep the internet global is to contain surveillance and censorship. And MLET is there for a deeply constitutional reason, deeply constitutional requirement that there must be some nexus between the approving official, the surveillance approving official, and the person subject to the surveillance. Not just between the official and the target, but also between the official and whoever or whichever company is holding the target's information. So we should not talk so easily about replacing that system with one global system, because that does not make the internet global. It makes the censorship and surveillance global, and we have to make that distinction. So I couldn't fill out the survey yesterday because one of the questions asked, you know, do I think whether we need more transnational cooperation? And it occurred to me, do we need transnational cooperation between governments, or do we need transnational cooperation between civil society and academia? I mean, if you're talking about cooperation between the governments, I mean, I just came from Johannesburg with a civil society meeting, and we saw multilateral intergovernmental sharing of intelligence as the biggest threat to people's privacy, right? So what we really need is not really more transnational cooperation between governments, but cooperation within each country, the government and civil society, something like transparency reporting that Rebecca mentioned, which set up a framework of a conversation between the civil society and the corresponding government, because it gives something for civil society to talk about when they engage the government. So, you know, we should not focus too much on making the global takedown and global or cross-border data access, you know, easier, because that is different from keeping the internet global. Now I'll have to run. Sorry about that. But
just as you're walking out, one vernacular precision on the term transnational. It is intentionally used in the context of internet and jurisdiction as a differentiator from international cooperation. International cooperation being understood as intergovernmental, and transnational is our attempt to use something that implies the involvement of all the stakeholders, governments included, and so on. So I wanted to clarify this. Now you can go. And see you tomorrow. And Pierrette. And we'll close the series of comments.
Yeah, thank you. First, of course, I would very much like to thank Bernard and Paul for their great work and for bringing us all here. It has been a very, very great meeting. And the second, I would also like to say to Eileen, thank you what you said, not only because we worked together in the Human Rights Council years ago, but because we have to stay the strongest and the biggest advocates of the global human rights and common understanding of that. The points that were made earlier, what our colleague from Iceland said, yes, there are many, many pieces of great works from the Council of Europe, and what Elfa mentioned, the recommendations of the Council of Europe, which were adopted in May, actually Estonia already made a pilot project on that. So just trying to evaluate our own human rights and freedom of expression and all this part. So there is a pilot project at least from one country already, and I would call on the others to to join us and to try to do it in your countries. And the second point what I wanted to make is to invite civil society also to help us, to help you in their countries, because I'm coming from the government of Estonia, and we are holding a lot of bilateral meetings and the dialogues with other countries, and also with the countries where the human rights are not always respected. So, and just the NGOs of these countries help us to help you as well. So it has to be our common effort to bring all the countries to respect the human rights as we'd like to see it to be. And my last point is just to congratulate Iceland and also being happy for Estonia, because there was a Freedom House report just came out last Monday, Freedom on the Net, and Estonia and Iceland are sharing the first place there. Yeah. So we continue. And maybe that's why also we are here, that we do really care. So thank you very much.
Thank you. Thank you so much. So we'll be moving to the closing, but before, allow me to share just a few thoughts. The main takeaway that I take is that in environments of uncertainty, and there can be legal uncertainty, political uncertainty, all sorts of uncertainty, and uncertainty is growing, people take contingency planning measures. They are anticipating the worst. And if it's uncoordinated, then the consequences are usually very bad. So this is an argument for dialogue and for channels of communication that are actually needed more than ever. It's not only about the bad consequences of doing nothing, it's the mitigation factors that can be bad. I'm convinced more than ever after this experience that bringing people together is actually the only solution to solve a problem. But I want to place this just for one second in a larger context. If you listen to cynics, they will always tell you that history is only about wars, kings, powers, and things like that. The reality is it may be the case, but it is also about another type of struggle, which is the constant effort of societies and humankind to organize themselves in larger and larger communities. And every single information revolution has made a leap in terms of the size of the communities. You get the language that brought tribes after families. You get the writing that produced the empires of antiquity. You get the printing press that brought the nation-state system that we have. And there's no reason why the internet and the digital age will not trigger as much or as big a problem. The challenge is that the speed and the scale are unprecedented. And that dealing with that is increasing the challenges that are usually triggered by change. That includes fear, overreactions, and tensions. And this is one of the reasons why we need particularly in this context to have particular efforts. And it is easy to be pessimistic in this environment, and we were reminded earlier this morning about the overall context and the other tensions that are not only jurisdictional. But there's a saying by Alain, who is a French philosopher, that pessimism is a matter of mood and that optimism is a matter of will. So fundamentally, the common challenge that we have, which is, as was said, I think, in the first day, to basically design or contribute to the design of the governance system of the digital age is of course a large challenge. But there's another saying that indicates that don't believe that small dedicated groups of people cannot change the world, because actually that's the way it has always been. So once again, I repeat what I said on the first day, and I think after those 3 days, it's even more visible. Collectively, the group of people that has gathered for those days represents a sort of critical mass of actors. And if the momentum and the desire and the commitment that you've demonstrated, we can keep it on, I'm convinced that it is possible, it will take time, but it is possible to address this. I'm very encouraged by those 3 days, and I'm encouraged also by the trends that have emerged behind the tensions. There are convergences. Come there. There are convergences. And actually, I'm happy to remind all of us that Netmundial a few years ago was the first event where the question of jurisdiction was actually mentioned as something that needed to be addressed. And this is something that is now growing, and that is very important. So our mission is to help you all achieve the objectives that you're putting for yourself. It is not only, we're already in discussions regarding where the host for the next event in 2017, and it's going well. I'm keeping my fingers crossed. If it works, it will be lovely. But it's not only a series of events, it's a process, as you know. And we will need to nurture this process to do part of research, as Paul has said, like commissioning papers, intensifying the outreach to respond to what Tarek was saying regarding reaching to other regions, to other groups of actors. Also supporting the ongoing work, which is the role of a secretariat, but it requires human resources. And also an element that we never mention in those conferences, but it's the question of providing support and travel support for people to participate in the meetings and the events that are taking place.